Morning, everybody. We have reason to sing hallelujah, right? Because the Lamb has overcome. Jesus is our King, He is our Lord, and He is head of the church. This morning, we're going to be talking about His church. We're going to be talking about deacons, quality of character, and their significance to the church. Now, the word deacon is derived from the root Greek word diakonos. The New Testament was written in Roman Greek, and it literally translates to mean servant. So throughout the New Testament, this word is used often. Many times it's simply used to mean servant. So if someone is serving, they would be called a deacon. In church history, it later became a word to mean an official office in the church, an office in the church that God ordained. We are here this morning to publicly recognize or ordain, to deem fit as a testimony of brothers, of brotherhood of deacons, and also pastors, Jafar Tucker and Jeremy Harger. This is their first time being publicly recognized or ordained as a deacon. Two other gentlemen, Dean Smith and John Jarrett, have been publicly recognized, and they have served elsewhere in another body. Praise the Lord, they've been brought here. So we're here to look at Scripture and understand the quality of character that must be present for a man to be deemed worthy to be called a deacon, to hold this official office. Also, we don't want to stop there, though. We want to acknowledge their significance to the church. I would even argue their significance to you if you're part of this church. So we're going to be looking at two passages this morning. You see it there, 1 Timothy chapter 3. I would encourage you to open your Bible to that passage. Put a holding place there. And then later we're going to be going to the book of Acts. Here in Timothy, we'll be looking at the qualifications or the quality of character of a deacon. Then we're going to be looking at a New Testament pattern of deaconhood there in Acts chapter 6 that will show us the work that the deacons are to do, but also help us understand and see the significance of deacons. This is an important discussion. The church in our Enon Baptist Constitution is described in fitting with Scripture that it is a body of believers to covenant together, to live in community, to worship the Lord and reach the lost, encourage one another. We might think of church organized like this. Jesus Christ is the head of the church. Next. Jesus Christ is the head of the church. Through His Holy Spirit, He indwells us, and we have in our Constitution laid out that in Article 4 and Article 5 that this church, in keeping with Scripture, is pastor-led. It is our job, our responsibility to lead. It is deacon-served. They are tasked with the huge responsibility of serving the body well. It is committee run. They do a lot of work. And then it's congregational rule. But look, we all might have different jobs or different functions, but we have the same status. I like to think of it this way. We all have various functions, pastor led. Next slide, please. You see there, we equal status, but different functions. And finally, I would ask you to look at this final graphic that shows that we're all part of one body. No one is greater than anyone else. God has ordained and designed His church to operate in such a fashion. Equally all priesthood unto God, tasked to be priests for the Lord, but inside the church we have different functions. So look, the priesthood of all believers, we preached a sermon, several of them actually. They're available now on YouTube on our channel. You can go back and look at those. That this idea of the priesthood of all believers, us all being ordained ministers for the Lord, it speaks to our status. We're all of equal status. But the office of pastor and deacon speaks to our function. We're no higher, no greater, no more important. We just simply have a different set of responsibilities and functions. So let's now look at some scriptures that deal with these officers in the church. We're going to notice a few things today. There are two primary classes of church leadership. Two offices, as we've already mentioned. Pastors hold leading, teaching, and equipping responsibilities, whereas deacons primarily exercise the responsibility to meet the physical, temporal needs of the church. Deacon means servant, one who serves in an official capacity here in the church. Now, why is this important? We need to arrange our thinking. We need to organize our church. We need to carry out this good work for several important reasons. One is we need to offer good, godly men and women opportunities to serve the Lord in the ways they can. Also, we want to adequately meet the needs of the entire church. We also want to maintain healthy leaders. We want to help leaders manage the demands of life and the challenges of ministry. We need good men to lead well and be deacons. Also, we need to avoid burnout. Sometimes the heavy load will weigh us down and us as leaders will get burned out. So we need to organize in this way to avoid that. Now, even more importantly, we need to do this so we can spur on good gospel-centered, Great Commission growth. You see, we need to resist the expectation that one person, three people, or 10 people do all the ministry. We need to resist that. When we're all engaged playing our part biblically, then Christ can grow His church. Often I would say this, churches don't grow because of the pastor. He wants to bottleneck everything through himself. Perhaps even it could be among the deacons or the teachers. We need to all engage in God's good work. We need to avoid territorial thinking that we own the church or this is somehow us, ours or mine. It's Jesus' church. Amen. We want to build a strong church. We want to build a strong church instead of tolerate a dying church. Hear me. This is important. Deacons, your role is important. Members, it's important that you understand the deacon role and take advantage of it. They're there to serve you. So here we are, 1 Timothy chapter 3. We're going to read several scriptures. The first half talks about the qualifications of an elder or pastor. Hear me, we use the word pastor here in America, but in scripture, the word elder, overseer, even bishop occasionally, those words all mean the same thing. Those of us that are tasked to lead, teach, and equip the church for its spiritual oversight. So that'll be the first half, and then we'll get to the deacons. Is everybody with me? Here we go. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1. This saying is trustworthy. If anyone aspires to the office of overseer, we use the word pastor, he desires a noble task. Therefore, an overseer must be above reproach. Must be the husband of one wife. Now I love my wife, but I can only handle my wife. Love the thing. Sober-minded, self-controlled, respectable, hospitable, and able to teach. Verse 3, he should not be a drunkard. Not violent, but gentle, not quarrelsome, not a lover of money. He must manage his own household well with all dignity, keeping his children submissive. Verse 5. For if someone does not know how to manage his own household, how will he care for God's church? Verse 6. He must not be a recent convert, a new Christian, or he may become puffed up with conceit and fall into the condemnation of the devil. And we're tasked to be seasoned men if we're going to lead. Verse 7. Moreover, he must be well thought of by outsiders, so that he may not fall into disgrace, into a snare of the devil. That is the quality of character demanded of a pastor. Man, that's humbling to even be considered to be near that. We all fall, we all make mistakes. With the Lord's help, man, we can serve him well. Now to the deacons, verse 8. Deacons, these servants, literally means servant, likewise must be dignified, not double-tongued, not addicted to much wine, not greedy for dishonest gain. They must hold the mystery of the faith with a clear conscience. He's talking about the gospel. We'll get to that later. Verse 10. And let them also be tested first, then let them serve as deacons if they prove themselves blameless. Do you see that? Verse 11. Their wives likewise must be dignified, not slanderers, but sober-minded, faithful in all things. Let deacons each be the husband of one wife, managing their children and their own households well. For those who serve well as deacons gain a good standing for themselves and also great confidence in the faith that is in Christ Jesus. So here we have the character qualifications of a deacon. First, he must be dignified. Now, this normally refers to something that is honorable, respectable, good, esteemed, worthy to be admired. You see, he must be respectable, a deacon. Men, you must be respectable. And this is also given to the elders, too. But men that are deacons must be respectable. Second, not double-tongued. We know what this is, right? Those people that are double-tongued, they say one thing to one group of people, and then they go say another thing to another group of people. They're untrustworthy, right? They might gossip, manipulate, slander. We cannot have deacons who are double-tongued, right? They must be honest with integrity. Thirdly, not addicted to much wine. A man is disqualified if he is a drunkard. This is a demonstration of lack of discipline and lack of self-control. Man, if men are going to lead and serve well, they have to be self-controlled and have a certain amount of discipline. One mark of not being disciplined, not being self-controlled, is drunkenness or addiction to other things even, but particularly drunkenness. Now, number four, they must not be greedy for dishonest gain. Doing stuff for their own gain, their own recognition, even monetarily, it could be considered. That can't be the attitude of service for a deacon, right? Not someone that's only after what they get for themselves or their own. We need deacons who are willing to serve for others. Fifthly, this is interesting. They must be sound in the gospel, where Paul says there in verse 9, they must hold this mystery. Hold the mystery of the faith with a clear conscience. Now, it's interesting, this phrase, the mystery of the faith, Paul uses it again later in this same chapter, chapter 3, verse 16. Hear it. This is what he says. Great indeed, Paul's saying, if we confess this mystery of godliness, and this is it. He was manifested in the flesh, Jesus. He was vindicated by the Spirit through miracles and God's own testimony, right? He was seen by angels, proclaimed among the nations, and believed on in the world, and finally Jesus was taken up into glory. You see, that's the concise gospel message. God sent His Son here to earth to perform miracles, be our perfect example, die an atoning death on the cross, to be testified by God that He was the Son, to be seen by angels, to be believed on in the world, and then taken up to heaven. Hear me, friend. Deacons must be sold out Christians, Bible-believing, and holding to this gospel. That's the kind of men that serve in the role of deacon. They must hold to the gospel without wavering. You see, that's partly how the church stays focused on the right thing. You see, if we have leaders and deacons that are not focused on gospel-centered community, gospel-centered evangelism, then that's how the church gets distracted and focused on all kind of crazy things. We need men that will help us pastors remain focused on the gospel. Number six, blameless. You see, Paul writes that deacons must be tested first and then let them serve as deacons. By the way, this kind of process was followed here. Folks nominated deacons. Those men were tested. Some were not qualified. Some decided that they weren't ready to serve. But four men were deemed qualified, keeping with this character. They thankfully are willing to serve. They have been tested, and they've been found to be blameless. Blameless is a general term, right? Speaking to a person's overall character. You see, we asked about personal background. We talked to others about their reputation. We had questions about their theological understanding and positions. You see, those are important. But also, we considered the track record of these men in the church. And it's interesting, looking back, hear me, they were already deacons. They were serving the role of deacon. They were serving the needs of the church. So we're simply recognizing that this morning. I would encourage us all to try to be deacons, though, right? In the general sense, to be serving. Seventh, now there's some debate about this portion here about their godly wives. Some claim this is speaking to a position of deaconess. We'll save that for a later discussion. From my point of view, and it seems to be the consensus of most scholars, this is talking about a deacon's wife. She too must be dignified, not a slanderer, right? See, sometimes when we know the hurts, the needs in the church, we are privy to personal family information. And if we're not careful, we can use that as an opportunity to go around and slander and spread gossip. Wives, don't be that. Must be sober-minded, temperate, right? Be able to make good judgment and not have a bunch of stuff in their life that would cloud good, sound judgment. Faithful in all things. Man, isn't that good? That they would be faithful in all things. Number eight, must be a husband of one wife. That's simple, right? Be faithful to his wife. Be a husband of one woman, physically and emotionally, right? To be dedicated wholly to his wife. And number nine, he must manage children and his household well. Isn't it tough to manage a household well? Isn't it difficult to manage children well? Well, I say if a man can do that, then he's worthy to serve at a church, right? Because some of us act like children even. No, I'm kidding. I didn't say that. Another pastor said that. Hey, man, sometimes it's challenging working with folks. We need people that are cool-minded, clear judgment, good folks. That's the kind of people. So those are the qualifications of a deacon. That's the quality of character that God demands of these servants. Now, this is important. Here in this text, when we look at it carefully, we see some distinctions between the qualifications of a deacon, a servant, and a pastor, overseer, elder, right? Now, number one is deacons do not need to be able to teach. If you're going to be a pastor, an overseer, an elder, you have to be able to teach. But see, deacons don't bear that responsibility. Can they teach? Yeah, we have some that do, and that's a good thing. But that's not a responsibility given to them by the Lord. They do not bear the load or have teaching responsibility or even authority in the church. Also, like deacons, they must manage their household well. But it's interesting that Paul omits this section when he talks about deacons. You see, in the elder section, he compares managing one's household to managing God's church. Now, this is most likely due to the fact that deacons do not bear the burden of overseeing and managing the church. Man, that's a sober thought for me. At the end of the day, it's the pastor's responsibility. Now, we seek counsel from good, wise, qualified men. But you know, they don't bear that burden. They contribute and help and serve the church, but we as pastors bear that burden. So they're not required to teach, and they're not required in Scripture to be an overseer. But they can help do both those things. This is interesting as well. Did you notice in the elder portion that it was required of a pastor that he not be a new convert? Because if he is, he might get puffed up with pride because he is in an overseeing position. But you know, a deacon can be a newer or younger convert. That's not one of the qualifications laid out here. So here we have overseer, pastor, elder, right? That it implies general oversight of the spiritual well-being of the church. And deacon implies one who serves the church. It's a service-oriented ministry. Now, all pastors should serve too, right? We have to be servant leaders as well. So now let's get to it. What are the significances of the deacon to the church? This should be both a challenge to the deacon and an encouragement to the pastor and an encouragement to the church member. I know for me, it was. We're going to see two things that the pattern established here in Acts chapter 6 is twofold. that the deacons would meet the needs of the congregation, but also help the pastors or the overseers or elders, whatever word you want to use, help and enable the pastors to accomplish their God-given calling, responsibility of leading, teaching, and equipping the church. Man, what a blessing it is to have that help. If I had to do it all on my own, I don't know that I could bear it. If the three pastors here had to do it all by ourselves, I don't think we could adequately do it. We need good, godly men. We need good, godly deacons to help us meet the needs of the church and help us carry out the task that God has given us. Here we are. Acts chapter 6, verses 1 through 7. Now, just to set the stage here, this is recorded history. This is narrative history inspired by the Holy Spirit. This is telling us, some things that happened in the early church. Jesus had ascended, sent his disciples to Jerusalem. The Holy Spirit came. They began to preach. Many believed on Jesus. The thousands were added to the church. Man, gospel, growth, miracles, community, fellowship, and now we're here and presented with a challenge. A healthy, thriving, gospel-centered, growing, dynamic church is now faced with a challenge. Here we are. Verse 1. Now in these days, when the disciples were increasing in number, you see, people were following Jesus. Disciples were increasing. A complaint by the Hellenists arose against the Hebrews because their widows were being neglected in the daily distribution. You see, this church was taking care of its widows. But the Hellenists, these Greek widows, their needs were not being met. So a complaint arose. Verse 2. And then the 12, these are the apostles, those followers of Jesus. The 12 summoned the full number of the disciples, everybody together, and they said this: It is not right that we should give up preaching the word of God to do serving of the tables. Did you get that? There's a problem here. Needs aren't getting met. A disagreement, a complaint arises. The apostles gather everybody together and they say, look, it's not right that we should stop preaching the word of God to serve tables. Therefore, brothers, hear this, pick out from among you 7 men of good repute. That's what we did here. Church, there's needs that are not being met. We need more servants. So we asked the church to put forth men of good repute. And he says, full of the Spirit and of wisdom, whom we will appoint this duty of serving the table, taking care of the Greek or Hellenist widows. Verse 4, notice this, the apostle speaking, but we will devote ourselves to prayer and to the ministry of the word. Do you see what's happening? They are identifying and raising up leaders to meet the need of the congregation so that the pastors, the overseers, can be devoted to the preaching and to prayer, to the ministry of the word. Notice this, verse 5. And what they said pleased the whole gathering, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith in the Holy Spirit. They chose Philip, and Prochorus, and Nicanor, and Timon, and Parmenas, and Nicholas, a proselyte of Antioch. These they set before the apostles, and they prayed and laid hands on them. Do you see that? We're going to do this later. We're going to follow this pattern. Church, you have put forth men of good repute, right? Good reputation, meet these qualifications, full of wisdom. We're going to recognize them just like the apostles recognized these first 7. We're going to lay hands on them and publicly acknowledge that they're going to be these servants in the church and they meet these qualifications. Now notice what happens in verse 7. And the word of God continued to increase. Isn't that good? And the number of the disciples multiplied greatly in Jerusalem, and a great many of the priests became obedient to the faith. Now, I want you to hear me well here. Sometimes disagreements like this can really create huge amounts of problems in a church. Have you ever known a church that went through a big time of struggle because there was a legitimate complaint and it wasn't handled well? That's kind of what is going on here. So we know the deacons meet the needs of the church and help the pastors. I want you to catch this. This is where the rubber meets the road. What does this mean for me and you? These men that are tasked with serving the church and helping the pastors. I want you to notice it. Think about Acts chapter 6. Even when the church was expanding, even when it was growing, even when things were healthy, some needs were not being met. The church needed deacons. Friend, it could be in our church that there are needs that I don't see. Needs that Pastor Ryan, Sunday school teachers, committee leaders, that we just don't see. We could even experience growth and all that, but there will be needs that will go unmet. When that happens, we need good, godly deacons. If you don't have your needs being met, reach out to a deacon. Next, when a legitimate complaint was voiced, they had a legitimate complaint, right? We Hellenists, us widows, our needs are not getting met. We're getting ignored. When a legitimate complaint was voiced, the church needed shock absorbers, someone to bear the load. The church needed deacons. You see, these deacons stepped up and they bore the extra work. Friend, look, in our church, you may have a legitimate complaint. We are here to serve and help you. Please don't keep that complaint to yourself. Please don't tell a bunch of people. Share your burden, sure, but man, come to us so we can raise up men and ask for help and get deacons to serve you, to meet your need. Thirdly, when the leaders, I want you to get it, when they were overworked and distracted, who did they need? They needed deacons. At times we get overworked, distracted, heavy burden, trying to manage life, and we can't do it all. Sunday school teachers can't do it all. But you know what? We can with the help of deacons. Friend, if you have a ministry position in the church, if you are leading a ministry program and you find yourself being overworked, under a heavy load, risking burnout, who do you need to see? Man, come to a pastor and go to a deacon. These men are here to serve you. I want you to get this. Boy, this was really encouraging. When men had to be handpicked, hand chosen, when they needed men who could be trusted, who did they pick? They picked deacons. Isn't that good that we have men of this quality in our church? Man, encourage a deacon. Tell him thank you. First of all, for living the kind of life that's worthy of being a deacon. But secondly, saying, I'm here to serve you. I'm here to help you. I'm here to put your needs above my needs. Personally, deacons, thank you. Thank you for serving Enon Baptist Church. Thank you for helping me, for helping the pastors. Thank you for meeting needs. You see, deacons were the obvious choice. Hear me. Lord, help us. Help me. When preaching, prayer, and ministry of the word needed to be held up and put center stage so that everybody doesn't get distracted and focused on other stuff, when that had to be valued above everything, somebody had to bear the load to enable that to happen. And who did? It was the deacons. You see, so many times in ministry, man, we can get bogged down with programmatic focus, event planning. meetings, right? I'll confess, some weeks, sermon preparation kind of gets put off. Prayer, well, I don't have time. I've got people to visit and work to do, right? Ministry of the Word, going out, being with people, sharing the gospel. Man, I've got work to do. I, myself, can get distracted, overworked, overburdened, and we need deacons. I need deacons. The church needs deacons. Finally, in closing, look. I want you to see it. This church was at a point where it could have went wrong, right? It could have went bad. This complaint, this disagreement, but they did the right thing, identified men, raised up deacons, and deacons carried out the work well. Notice it. Deacons served, needs of the church were met, and the word of God continued to increase. It is my prayer that that would be Enoch Baptist Church. It is my prayer as a pastor to have deacons helping and serving. It is my prayer that all the needs of the church are being met. It is my prayer that the word of God would continue to increase. Do you agree?
Amen.
Amen.